start our program with Tilawat-e-Quran by our MPhil student, Sujad.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا طلاها والنهار إذا جلاها والليل إذا يغشاها والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما طواها ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها قد أفلح من زكاها فقد خاب من دساها كذبت ثمود بطغواها إذ انبعث أشقاها. In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful. By the sun and its rising brightness, and by the moon as it follows it, and by the day as it reveals it, its glory, and by the night when it draws a veil over it, by the sky and how he built it, and by the earth and how he spread it, and by the soul and how he formed it, then inspired it to understand what was the right and what was the wrong. He who purifies it will indeed be successful, and he who corrupts it is sure to fall. Jazakallah.
Now I request our HOD, Ms. Kanizara, to welcome the guest.
Assalamu alaikum. Aaj ka din intihai pur masrat hai ke aaj shobe siyasat aur nazm o naqsh ama do roza qaumi seminar munaqid kar raha hai. मैं यूनिवर्सिटी की जानिब से और डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ पॉलिटिकल साइंस और पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन की जानिब से आप सभी का तहे दिल से खैर मकदम करती हूँ. गुड मॉर्निंग. आई वेलकम ऑल द डिग्निटरीज ऑन द डायस ऑफ द डायस एंड ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स हु हैव कम फ्रॉम डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द कंट्री फॉर प्रेजेंटिंग देयर पेपर्स हियर एंड ऑल्सो टू पार्टिसिपेट in the seminar. I extend a very warm welcome to all of them. Is seminar mein muntakhiba mekhale pesh kiye jayenge aur aap in mekhalon se mehsoos honge aur kuch aisi nayi baatein aur soch in mekhalon ke zariye pesh ki jayegi. The two-day national seminar, the third national seminar on educational development of minorities, policy initiatives and impact, focuses on educational development of minorities, and the seminar revolves around themes and sub-themes like all nation states have their share of minorities. Integrating the interest of minorities with the national development is imperative for the growth of any nation. Indian Constitution has guaranteed cultural and educational rights to its minorities. And there are various policy initiatives like 15-point program for the development of concentrated districts. Development of education among minorities has been a focal point of all these programs. Muslims, who constitute more than 70% of the minority population, have the lowest literacy rate among all religious communities. Sachar Committee report corroborates the census data and reveals that as many as 25% Muslim children in the age group of 16 to 14 years have either never attended school or dropped out. The incidence of dropout is high among the Muslims, and only SCs and STs have marginally higher dropout rate than Muslims. While the mean year of schooling for an average child is 4 years, it is only about 3 years, 4 months for Muslims. While 26% of those 17 years and above have completed matriculation, this percentage is only 17 amongst Muslims. According to this report, while 7% of the population aged 20 years and above are graduates or hold diplomas, this proportion is less than 4% amongst Muslims, and among these, the technically qualified are 0.4%. The gap between Muslims and other socio-religious communities increases as the level of education increases. The study published in November 2008 by UGC on higher education in India, issues related to expansion, inclusiveness, quality and finance, shows there is a huge gap between the Muslims and other socio-religious groups. However, the education level of Muslim minority is not the same in all the states. In 10 out of 21 states studied by Sachar Committee, literacy rate among Muslims is higher than the state average, which includes states like Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Maharashtra, Gujarat, and Jharkhand. There is a need to analyze the causes for the better educational attainment of Muslim community. In some states, while their counterparts in other states are lagging behind. It is in this context the national seminar focuses on policy initiatives, their implementation, impact, and the best practices in the field of educational development of minorities. Objectives of the seminar are as follows: to provide a platform to the policy makers, government officials, academicians, and non-governmental organizations to debate and discuss the issues concerning educational backwardness of minorities, to evaluate the efficacy of existing policies of the central as well as the state governments for the educational development of minorities, to analyze the merits of the shortfalls of the educational policies for the minorities, to project the best practices and innovative measures in the field of education of minorities, and finally, to discuss alternative policies and practices for the development of education among minorities. The seminar received a very good response because we had papers coming from almost all the different states, covering north, south, east, and west also. So this seminar has papers representing an All India outlook as such, and an effort is made to see that the outcome of the seminar would be very fruitful and would also help in policy formulation as well as, implementation as well. I once again extend my warm welcome to the dignitaries on the dais, of the dais, and all the participants who have assembled here for their participation in the seminar. I hope their stay here for 2 days would be very comfortable. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for your briefing about the seminar. Now, not as a customary traditions, but as a passionate desire, we would like to facilitate our esteemed guests with bouquets. I request our PhD scholar, Riaz, to present the bouquet to our guest, Amit Kunduz sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Riyaz. Now, Samina of final year MA will present the bouquet to Dr. Fazal Ghafoor, sir. Please accept this token. Thank you, Samina. Now, Rashida of final year MA will present the bouquet to our Pro VC, Khaja sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Rashida. Zareen, our first year MA, will present the bouquet to our registrar, but in his absence, he's not there. Now, before inviting our guest of honor for speech, his brief intro would be, Dr. Fazal Ghafoor is the president of the Muslim Educational Society, Calicut, which is one of the biggest social organization of educational agency of the Muslim community in India. Sir has pursued his degree, MBBS, MD, DM from Kerala, Hyderabad, and Madras. By professional and perhaps by passion, he is founder, director, professor, and HOD of Neurology, MES Medical College, Kerala. He is very much associated with social activities, and for this, he has been awarded with number of awards. Kerala, example, Kerala State Award for the Best Doctor in 2011, Kerala State Award for the Best Social Worker in 2010, Best Socio-Educational Worker Award 2014, instituted by the American Muslims of Indian origin. Now, I request our sir guest for the speech.
Okay. Respected Shahid Khwaja Sahib, Professor Kundu, Professor Khanis, esteemed audience, friends, Assalamu Alaikum, Namaskar. At the outset, I have to thank Professor Khwaja, who is a childhood associate of mine, because he is very close to my father. And I still remember 30 years ago, as a student of Usmania Medical College, I went to attend a conference at Delhi, which was organized by Khwaja Sahib. That is an All India Muslim Education Conference. At that time, he was a strapping, very handsome young man. Even today, he is handsome. Usme koi shak. उसमें कोई शक नहीं है कि अभी भी वो नौजवान है कभी कभी मैं उर्दू में भी बोल सकता हूँ कभी कभी हिंदी में भी बोल सकता हूँ और मुझसे पूछे तो ये दोनों भाषाओं को अलग करना दोनों जुबानों को अलग करना ठीक नहीं किया आप लोगों ने आपने भी ठीक नहीं किया अभी सरकार भी ठीक नहीं कर रहे क्योंकि अभी अभी मैं हवाई जहाज में आ रहा था उसको हवाई जहाज नहीं कहते आजकल उसको विमान कहते हैं शिमले पे उधर आकर उन लोगों ने कहा था आप बैठ जाइए आप तशरीफ रखिए दोनों तो मालूम हो सकता है लेकिन उपविष्ट हो जाइए और उपलब्ध है पानी उपलब्ध है जल उपलब्ध है अनफॉर्चुनेटली आई नो द लैंग्वेजेस ऑफ संस्कृत उर्दू हिंदी तेलुगु तमिल मलयालम ऑफ कोर्स इंग्लिश सो आई कुड अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज गोइंग ऑन बट इफ यू गो टू द कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंसी ऑफ लेट अस से सासाराम इन बिहार Jagjivan Ram's constituency, and if you say Pani Jal Yahan Ubalapte, they'll run away. But none of them are going to understand what's going on. So that is a position over as far as languages, because I started speaking on languages because I know that I am standing in Urdu University, and I just listened to the first two sentences of Professor Khanis, and I was not at all happy with that. Because it is not Urdu, it is Urdu, Pakka Urdu, Pak Urdu. ना तो हम शुद्ध हिंदी चाहते हैं ना तो पाक उर्दू चाहते हैं हम हिंदुस्तानी चाहते हैं अब समझे ना जो समझ में आ सकते हैं समझे जो ना समझ है उससे बोलने से क्या फ़ायदा है समझे सो व्हाट हैपेंस इन ऑल दीज ऑडियंसेस व्हेनेवर आई गो टू एनी फंक्शन इन नॉर्थ इंडिया द पीपल स्टार्ट स्पीकिंग ईदर इन शुद्ध हिंदी विच दे डोंट अंडरस्टैंड कुंडू साहब और दे स्टार्ट स्पीकिंग इन पाक उर्दू विच ऑल्सो द ऑडियंस डजंट अंडरस्टैंड मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम So anyhow, I wanted to present a paper on the Kerala model. See, everybody speaks about the Kerala model. Taajub ki baat ye hai ki aap bharosa nahi karenge ki केरला में मुसलमानों को 9 मेडिकल कॉलेज है, 9 मेडिकल कॉलेज है, 60 इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज है और 250 आर्ट्स एंड साइंस कॉलेज है. सी दिस इज अनबिलीवेबल इज़न्ट इट कि हिंदुस्तान में ऐसा हो सकता है कि एक स्टेट जहां मुसलमानों का पॉपुलेशन जो है इज ओनली 75 लाख्स, समझे, दे आर हैविंग दिस मच ऑफ रिसोर्सेस. ओके, सो दैट इज द फर्स्ट थिंग विच आई वांट. As far as my society is concerned, we are running 31 colleges. The total student and staff strength is more than 1 lakh, which means it is bigger than Aligarh. Any day it is bigger than Aligarh, because our medical college is bigger than Aligarh Medical College. We have got more than 54 seats, postgraduate seats, MD seats there. Aap samjhe, so this is not a joking affair. So I will go into the historical background of Kerala, because I am very much pleased that Kundu Saab is here. Because yesterday only in Times of India, I read the recent review of Kundu Saab's report on this. Kerala is a model to be emulated by everybody. There is no doubt about that. The question is that, ki aap emulate kar sakte ki nahi kar sakte. That is another issue is there. So first we will go into the historical background of Kerala. The historical background of Kerala is entirely different from that of the other states of India, because there has been neither Aryan invasion nor what you call Turco-Persia-Arab invasion. I always use that word. I will never use the word Muslim invasion. There is no such Muslim invasion in India. It is either Muhammad bin Qasim, who is an Arab, or it is Babur, who is a Mongol, or it is the Persians who have come here, okay? Or it is the people who came from Samarkand. Those people, so they have come from various countries. Their religion was also going on changing. For example, Babur is directly related to Timur, and he is related to Genghis Khan. Both of them were not Muslims. Genghis Khan and Timur are not Muslims. Conversion occurred later on. Okay, so the issue was that Kerala was never under foreign rule. So that is the first point in Kerala. Second thing, Kerala mein, there is no majority, no minority. Kerala's population, demographic population is 26% Muslim and 20% Christian, which makes 46%. Minus the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, whom I always consider, they are not Hindus. They are scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. Okay? So that means that the Kerala's population is equal. Barabar. Second. Third thing, because we were not invaders, nobody could point a finger at us. आप समझे ना कि दीज आर फॉरनर्स, दे आर इन्वेडर्स, दे आर आर्यंस, दे आर पर्शियंस, दे आर तुर्कीस. नो, वैसा नहीं था. सो वी आर ऑल सन्स ऑफ द सॉइल. सो दैट इज द नेक्स्ट इश्यू अबाउट केरला. देन द फर्दर एडवांटेजेस इश्यू विच ओकर्ड टू अस वाज दैट द महाराजास ऑफ ट्रिवांकूर एंड कोचिन. फर्स्ट केरला वॉज लाइक वी हैव द सेम थिंग, तेलंगाना, रॉयल सीमा, आंध्रा इश्यू वी हैव देयर, ट्रिवांकूर, कोचिन, मलबार. Same thing, almost. And Malabar is backward. Telangana, like that. I come from Malabar. So now what has happened is that in the state of Kerala, the Maharajas, like the Maharaja of Kolhapur, the Maharajas of Travancore and Cochin were very benevolent. So they included us as OBCs. So this OBC reservation started from the time of the Maharajas itself. One portion of ours was in Malabar, was in Tamil Nadu. There also we were very fortunate. Because when the Justice Party came to power in 1920s, and when Periyar E.V. Ramaswamy Nayaka's philosophy was ruling over Tamil Nadu, at that time, Periyar said that the Muslims are OBCs. They are also what you call Manindamakkal, or the sons of the soil. So they should be given reservation. So that portion which came from Tamil Nadu also, they also came under the reserved category. In 1957, what happened, they all got integrated. And so we got the benefit of reservation from the advent of the state itself. And that reservation is continuing till day, which I will come to when we come to the reservation issue. So that is another thing. Another major thing is the influence of Christianity. See, Kerala is the only state where the Christians are, a major state where the Christians are having a very dominant position. Out of 150 aided colleges in the state of Kerala, 77 are run by the Christian community. Out of 5,000 are all aided schools in the, what is aided means where the government pays a salary. Okay. Out of 5,000 are all aided schools, nearly 3,000 are run by the Christian community. So that means we had this chance of getting a modern, egalitarian sort of situation. So situation already prevailing in the state by the time we came up. Already this, it is not like a Bihar or a UP-like situation. It is a situation entirely different in the state of Kerala. Another good thing which occurred was that instead of the Hindutva forces coming to power, or the Hindutva forces being dominant, at least at a subaltern level, in the state of Kerala, the major political formation was communist. Now the communists being, they were, what should I say, agnostic towards religion. Understand? They were agnostic towards religion. So they were not bothered. They were not bothered. So they always used to look at the minority communities. Ki chal raha hai. They are having some activity over there because their major vote bank was the majority community. So that means the majority community's vote bank, wherever it had an atheist form, whether it is the Dravidian parties in Tamil Nadu or the Communist Party in Kerala, we have found that there is no communal strife. This is a very important point. Wherever the majority community, what Jawaharlal Nehru said was that majority communalism is more dangerous than minority communalism. So the same thing occurred in the states of Kerala and Karnataka, in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, where the majority community opted for an atheist philosophy, either through the Dravidian philosophy of Periyar or through the communist philosophies. What happened is that there was no conflict because there is no inter-religious fight, because the other side there is no religion. So what happened was that is yet another point whereby Kerala. Now, more important is that yahan there is no clash of civilizations in Kerala. Yahan kya ho raha hai Hyderabad mein? Hyderabad mein clash of civilization hai. Aapko to malum hai ki aapka Ganga Jamuna tehzeeb jo aap log kehte hai. Samjhe, yahan Ganga Jamuna ka tehzeeb nahi tha. Na to wo Krishna Godavari ka tehzeeb tha. Yahan clash tha. Razakar movement ke time se there has been a clash of civilizations, because in a small area, in a small city of, let us say, if my memory is correct, around 60 crore population, we have got two, Charminar ki taraf se ek civilization, and is taraf Secunderabad ki taraf se, there is another civilization. It is a fact, because I used to study in the border, Usmania Medical College, that is Afzal Ganj is exactly in the border between the two civilizations. So I used to get patients from both sides. Telugu-speaking patients and Urdu-speaking patients. So, of course, at that time, there was, of course, that Ramizabi incident occurred at that time. But that's an entirely different issue. You know, that's a political issue. I don't consider it to be as a clash between two communities. It is more of a political issue. So what happened is that in the state of Kerala, because we had a single culture, we speak the same language, Malayalam. None of us know Urdu. The only Muslim who knows Urdu in the state of Kerala is the humble myself, who doesn't appear to be very humble. Okay, but so there is only one language, Malayalam language. All of us wear the same mundu, all of us wear the same lungi in the night. We are all chawal eaters, okay. And everybody in Kerala is a beef eater. See, Kerala, the majority community eats beef. So the culture, interchange of culture is from both sides. It's not that we are absorbing that culture, their culture alone. You go to my city of Calicut, you won't find a single vegetarian restaurant. All restaurants are non-vegetarian only. Whatever the Woodlands and whatever they tried to open, Dash Prakash, they had to close down. Because there were no customers for this, except for this morning Idli Dosha fair. Morning everybody prefers this breakfast. Nowadays, all over India it is like that. Even North India it is so. So there is no problem regarding the culture. So we come from the same stock. See, now we have to go into a bit of ethnology and a bit of anthropology also. So anthropologically, all the Kerala Muslims come from the same stock. If you look at me, I look like many, when I was studying here, many of these people used to say that I resemble many of the Telugu villains. And especially Krishnamuraju and Chiranjeevi. At that time, they were villains. They were not heroes at that time. They were acting as villains in those days. So they used to say, you resemble many of us, like that. So even though they say that there is some contact between the Arabs and us, Kundusab, actually there is no contact because we don't have any foreign blood in us, because none of us resembles Khwaja Saab. Wo toh dikhta hai European, Aryan hai, samjhe, Savarn hai, samjhe. We call avarna and savarna. I don't know whether you call, use the same word. Savarna means the belonging to the forward caste. What do you call Sanskritized group, what do you call it? So we belong to the same stock. That is recognized by the locals also. Ki apnai aadmi hai. So all these points used to help us. And now we come to what you call, what I would like to come to the negative points which we had. All these things were only the positive points which we had. And now another thing was that never there was an accusation against us ki these people have been converted by force. The Sangha Parivar always used to say that conversion is by force. But against us, that issue is not, because there is no ruling class as far as Kerala is concerned. There is no Muslim ruling dynasty in the state of Kerala. It is never there. And Kerala was always happy under the Hindu dynasties. And we were the most loyal servants of the Hindu Maharajas over there. And the Zamorin of Calicut, as you know, he used to employ the Marakas. They are called the Kunya. The Marakas are a group of admirals. It's not one Marakar, so many Marakars. Kunyari Marakar is the famous, most famous admiral who fought against the Portuguese. So we were the most loyal subjects of the Maharajas of Travancore and Cochin. So that also, we didn't have any fight with them. So naturally what happened, these Maharajas, they were always in favor of us in granting lands. So for example, I belong to the landed gentry of Kerala. So that means there is a group of us who were having lands also, who were supposed to be aristocrats also. That group also was there. It's not that we were only purely OBCs. It is not that way. So all these factors put together, the advent of communism, then partition. Hindustan ka batwara ka koi asar Kerala ke upar nahi pada, kyunki Kerala ka batwara nahi hua. Hyderabad ka batwara hua tha, kyunki Osmanistan bolke concept aa gaya us zamane mein. Us zamane mein Osmanistan ka concept tha. कि एक दूसरा एक मुल्क बनाएंगे यहां उसका नाम उस्मानिस्तान है लेकिन ऐसा कोई कांसेप्ट नहीं था केरला में तो वो भी नहीं था तो सो कोई दंग फसाद भी नहीं हुआ था केरला में बंटवारा के टाइम में या हिंदुस्तान के बंटवारा के बाद आजादी के बाद कभी कोई दंग फसाद केरला में नहीं हुआ था तो ये भी एक बात है सो ऑल दीस फैक्टर्स पुट टुगेदर व्हाट हैज हैपेंड इज दैट अ मोस्ट हार्मोनियस रिलेशनशिप हैज बीन एस्टैब्लिश्ड between all the major communities existing in the world at that time, including a small Jewish community in the state of Cochin. So Christian, Muslim, Dalit, Adivasi, Dravida, aap samjhe na, Dravida bhi hai, this is a Dravida state hai. So all these things, they were going in harmony. So this fight was not there. So that is over. Now we come to the negative points. Negative point kya hai puche to? The most important negative point is that, as Khwaja Ahmad Abbas used to say, I am not an island, but we were an island. We remained an island within the Muslim setup of India. We remained an island within the Hindu setup of India also. We didn't have any connection with the Hindu setup of India. Means the Hindus of Kerala didn't have. The Muslims of Kerala also didn't have. They were in isolation because they didn't know Urdu, they didn't know Hindi also. Donon zamanon se waqif nahi tha wo sab. So they were cut off from the rest of India. That is the first point. Second point is that because these people were OBCs, naturally they are the OBCs all over India have suffered. They have suffered all over India, whether they are Muslim OBCs as enumerated by Mandal, or whether they are Hindu OBCs as per the caste system of Hinduism, or whether the OBCs according to the Dravida system also we had OBCs. Those OBCs, they have suffered. So the Muslim OBCs also have suffered. We were cut off from modern education, we were cut off from reading whatever is the material, whether religious or non-religious at that time, so that we had to improvise and form a script of our own. That is called Arabi Malayalam. That is Malayalam written in the Arabic script. That was the language used by the Muslims up to 1920. That means they were prevented from learning the Malayalam language, whether prevented from within or from without, we don't know. But they were prevented and they were reading and writing in Malayalam, and most of the Malayalam literary works, including the Mahakavyas, are in Arab Malayalam. So what is Arab Malayalam? Again, I am telling you, Malayalam written in an Arabic script. It is Malayalam only, but written in an Arabic script with a few words, Arabic words in between. But it's not mainly Arabic. It may be only 5% Arabic. 95% is Malayalam language only. So that was the next thing which we had. Then we had another thing, as you know, I already said, we were serfs. Most of the people were not being, 99% of the people were serfs. the landowning gentry in Kerala was only around 1%. So that is also a point which was against us. Then the upright is uprisings. I don't know, I expect there are a lot of historians sitting here. If you go into the history of the uprisings of India, they say 1857, Damodar Vinayak Savarkar said that should be called the first war of independence. Sir Kundu Sahab, my request is that the Malabar Rebellion in 1921 should be called the second war of independence. Because that is also an armed uprising in which thousands of people died, including the wagon tragedy. People have tried to give it a communal brush. They have tried to paint it in communal colors by saying that, see, this is a Muslim uprising, so it should be called the Mopla Rebellion. No. Now most of the historians, they agree that either it is an agrarian revolt, as per the communist historians, or it could be a part of the freedom struggle. So my request always is that it should be called the Second War of Independence. Because nobody had, in 1921, nobody had the guts to take up arms against the British. Nobody had the guts. And it was a part of an ongoing battle. It is not one rebellion. It is a continuous rebellion in the state of Malabar. Malabar, as you know, is the Muslim-dominant area of Kerala. So it was a continuous, thousands of Muslim martyrs occurred. I will give you a small story where MES had to intervene. In 1942, a courageous young man called Vakkam Abdul Qadir. He landed, not Abdul Qadir Maulavi, sir, it is different. Vakkam Abdul Qadir. He was an INA Fauji who fought under Subhash Chandra Bose. He came in a submarine. He landed at a place called Tanur, that is around 25 kilometers from Calicut. And he came for subversive activities. He was caught by the British and he was hanged. History has forgotten him. Now MES, 3 months ago, decided to erect a memorial to Vakkam Abdul Qadir at the beach where he landed. And the chief minister has put the foundation stone for this. So, in the freedom struggle, along with the INA, the Keralite Muslims have been working. So, from 1921 to 1947, of course, in 1937, a small aberration occurred. Sir, a portion of these people went and joined, misadvertently, they went and joined the Muslim League, the original Jinnah League. You will be surprised to know that the Kerala Muslims were a staunch part of the All India Muslim League of Jinnah. They suddenly changed from 1937. As you know, the historical elections of 1937 and the historical blunders committed at that time. So a portion of the Muslims went and joined the Muslim League. The Hindus, what they did, they left the Congress and they went and joined the Communist Party. By 1942, the Congress Socialist Party had got converted into the Communist Party. So that is how the Communists were. So because of the fallacies of the Congress leadership at that time, they have got divided into Communists. The Hindus became Communists and the Muslims became League. Fortunately for us, in 1947, some of the League leaders, after independence, they went to Jawaharlal Nehru. As you know, Jawaharlal Nehru is a great patriot and a great secularist and a great free thinker. They requested Jawaharlal Nehru that could we not form a Muslim League in the state of India? Nehru said, of course you can form, but we should be allowed to form the Congress in Pakistan. That is the formula, he said. And according to this Indian Union Muslim League has been formed in the state of Kerala. Now, the Indian Union Muslim League is a benevolent, and it is a, what should I say, I'm not a leaguer, first of all, don't take it that way. It's a, what should I say, a middle of the road party. So it is not badkawa nahi karte logon ka nahi badka, matlab ki they never used to stoke these communal sort of issues and all. And that has also helped us, because politically we have been able to strike bargains within the format of the democratic setup of India. So that is another issue which has been helpful to us. And we were speaking about the negative points. So from 1921, what happened? The mullahs and the maulavis, they said that nothing to do with English education. Ye foreign, ye vilayati hai, and we should not take up this education. And so from 1921 to, let us say, 1960 or 1950s, end of 1950s, we were away from English education. We were either going to the madrasas or we were writing this Arab Malayalam. We were not in tune with the times. We were not in tune with the Malayalam language. We were not following the English education which is going on in the state. That is how we became backward. So now I think I have given you a brief summary of what is the situation of the Kerala Muslims, how they are, what their weaknesses are, and what their strengths are, and what is the... Now I am coming to the present position. Now I would like to interpolate this present position with... Because Kundu Saab is here, I would like to interpolate these things with the Sachar Commission, the Ranganath Mishra Commission, and the Kundu Commission. All three things, because Kundu Saab is here, I am very happy because I have this doubt about this Ashrafi, Ajlafi, and Arzal Muslim issue. This is something which is not entering my head. because I don't know whether such a thing exists. But anyhow, I think Professor Kundu in his lecture, he will be able to clarify this issue. Now, when we come to, we'll go back. As you know, the major reason for the success of the Keralite Muslim is the reservation policy followed by the state of Kerala. Already I told you how they were given reservation in the time of the Maharajas. In 1957, when the state of Kerala was formed, the EMS, that is a communist ministry actually, the EMS ministry introduced what is known as quota within quota. Now that is what the Indian Muslims require. That is, it took 50 or 60 years for that to be introduced in the state of Andhra Pradesh by Rajasekhar Reddy. It took another 30 years to be introduced in the state of Karnataka by Devarajars after the Havanur Commission report came. So Kerala state in 1957 they have introduced that. How what is the percentage introduced? I'll tell you. In educational institutions we get 8% reservation. That is within the 27% given to the OBCs. And reservation is for almost all Muslims. You see, all are considered to be OBC. But there is no such thing like Sheikh, Sayyid, that thing. I don't know how the Sheikhs and Sayyids have been absorbed. There are Sayyids there also. For example, in the Tangal family, they are Sayyids. We have Sayyids there also. One. Another portion of us was in Lakhadives, as you know. Lakhadives, these people are enjoying the benefit of being ST, scheduled tribe, Muslim, so that means they get minority status. Then they become OBC also, you understand. So they get all the benefits. All three benefits they are getting. So in the Kerala state, if they apply, they'll put their name, simply they'll put as Muslim, OBC, they'll get that reservation. Central government, they'll put as ST, they get that reservation. So I was just mentioning Lakhadives because this is an entirely different sort of situation in Lakhadives. So what happened was that, after this reservation policy was introduced, in the employment, what happened in 1957? In employment, 12% reservation was given. The Muslim population of the state of Kerala is only 26%, but 12% reservation is given. At that time, it was not 26%. That recently it has grown. 1957, the Muslim population in the state of Kerala was only 18%. Now it has become 20. Now latest census we have not got, but it is 24.7. We expect it to be around 26% this time. Okay, and it is now hereafter it is going to be static, because the Hamara Do Aapka Teen, that chakra is going to end. Or Hamara Do Tumhara Char, or Hamara Char Tumhara Do, jo bhi ho. That situation has now changed in the state of Kerala. All the people are now having only 2 or 3 children. So the population level is going to get plateaued almost. So the first was the reservation policy. So the reservation policy was being followed in all aspects, including recent amendments, even in the universities. So that was what the major issue, which according to me, which was of help to the this thing was, the reservation policy. Then the political reservation, especially for women. See, Keralite women Keralite Muslims, as everywhere, they are very shy, they are not ready to come into the public domain, and they remain, what should I say, aloof from politics and other things. But after the Rajiv Gandhi introduces Panchayati Raj issue, 50% reservation has been made mandatory. So wherever the Muslims are in majority in the state of Kerala, we are in a majority in, let us say, around 15 constituencies in the state of Kerala. At least in those constituencies, the panchayats and the municipalities, the women have been forced to come forward. Many of these women are benami, of course. They are benami for their husbands. Wo chakkar to abhi bhi chal raha hai, sunje. Ki usko aage kada karke, the peeche se wo chalte rehte, sunje. But phir bhi, So that this reservation policy has been of great benefit to the Muslim community in the state of Kerala. Muslim, women's reservation, OBC reservation. We do not have any Dalit Christians, Dalit Muslims. There are no Dalit Muslims in the state of Kerala. So that issue does not come. That is one issue which has come up. And this 4.5% reservation, Kundu Sahab, we are not in agreement with that. Because I do not know how this has popped up. This 4.5% reservation is a wrong move. Because 4.5 means lumping the minorities together. How you can put the minorities together, I don't understand. Because the Christians are a forward, as far as the state of Kerala is concerned, this is a forward community. Sikhs are a forward community. Jains are, Parsis are a forward community. You put three forward, six are a forward community. Person along with the OBCs, where we would have stood a better chance along with the Yadavs and the Kurmis and the Koharis and the Ahirs and all those groups. Because with them, there is not much of a difference. This difference is not there because they are not forward castes. Even today, I have found out that probably they only occupy 6 to 8% of the central government services. So it would have been better for us to compete with them and try to come up in the, as a part of the Mandal package. Instead of that, we have a new reservation package and we are not at all happy with this reservation package. Then, sir, we are coming to the Sachar Commission report. Now, Sachar Commission report, sir, I have been a member of the High Power Implementation Committee called Paloli Committee in the state of Kerala. I am surprised, Kundu Sahab,